fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. We gather here to unite in the gifts that God has given us and to rejoice in God's good news of forgiveness and freedom that is offered to us and to all the world. If we live by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit. Let us worship the Lord our God. Please join me in our opening collect. Let us pray together to the Lord. From Jordan to Jericho, from then to now, to heal the sick, to comfort the disturbed, to disturb the comfortable, to face down the powers of this world, to carry the cross, to shoulder the sin of the world and take it away. Be seated. Let us join together in our responsive reading of Psalm 119. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims God's handiwork. Day to day, the Lord's works will be, and night to night, the heavens are telling the glory of God. There is no speech, nor are there words. Their voice is not heard, yet their beauty goes out around the world and to all the edges of the earth. Which comes out like a bridegroom from his wedding canopy, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul.
The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart.
The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever.
The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Thanks be to God for God's two beautiful books, the book of creation and the book of law. Amen.
Friends, hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority on heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And lo, I am with you always, even to the close of the age. Obeying the words of our Lord Jesus and confident of his promises, we baptize those whom God has called to be God's own. In baptism, God claims us and puts a sign on us to show that we belong to God. God frees us from sin and death, uniting us with Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of Christ's body, the church, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, justice, and peace. As we celebrate this sacrament, let us remember with joy our own baptisms. So Andrew and Candace Hill are here to present their daughter Hadley Ray for baptism this morning, and I am pleased to introduce you to Peter Hill and Megan Hinkleman, who will serve as Hadley's godparents.
Thank you.
So Andrew and Candace, in presenting your daughter for baptism, you announce your own faith in Jesus Christ and show that you want your daughter to know him, to love him, and to serve him as his chosen disciple. Please show your purpose by answering these questions. Andrew and Candace, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
We do.
Do you trust in him?
We do.
Do you intend for your child to be his disciple, to obey his love, and to show his word?
We do.
The congregation, please stand. People of faith, our Lord Jesus ordered us to teach those who are baptized. Do you, the people of this church, promise to tell this new disciple the good news of the gospel, to help her to know all that Christ commands, and by your fellowship to strengthen the family ties with the household of God? If so, please answer, we do.
We do.
You may be seated. Please pray with me. Oh God, we thank you for your faithfulness promised in this sacrament and for the hope we have in your Son, Jesus. As we baptize with water, baptize also with Holy Spirit, so that what we say may be your word and what we do may be your work. By your power, may we be made one with Christ our Lord in common faith and purpose. O God, who's called us from death to life, we give ourselves to you, and with the church through all the ages, we thank you for your saving love. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And what is the Christian name of this child?
Hadley Ray.
Hadley Ray. Hadley Ray, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Friends, see what love the Father hath, that we should all be called children of God, and so we are. Guys, this is Hadley Ray. Isn't she being good? So, Andrew and Candace, congratulations to you. Thank you for letting all of us participate in this auspicious day in the life of your young family. We'll ask God's blessing upon you and your beautiful and well-behaved daughter through all the years to come. And we have some grandparents from Michigan here and grandparents from Chicagoland here. So, a welcome to you and congratulations to you. Andrew was baptized at Kenilworth Union. And this is the baptismal cloth that he used when he was baptized. So we'll give this to you. And this candle is burning on the font to represent the light of Christ that we're positive Hadley will take with her through all the years to come. And here is a baptismal certificate. Andrew and Candace, we'll leave this candle burning during the service and then afterwards take it home with you, okay? It's yours. And so congratulations to you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest on you and those you love now and always. Amen.
As we enter into prayer this morning, we give thanks to God for the life of Hadley and for her witness and light here in this place. We also pray for those who have asked us to pray for them this week, and I know that there are many. In particular, we extend our hearts to the family of Steve Cole, who died yesterday. We give thanks to God for the gift of life and the promise of life eternal. A memorial service will be held for Steve on March 20th at 1 p.m. here in our congregation. Let us join together in prayer. Holy God, we give you thanks for the gift of creation, the warmer days, and the hope for spring. We glimpse your presence in the world around us, and we hear your story woven into our lives. You are to us a shelter in the storm, an ark carrying us to safety. You are a guide in the night, a pillar showing us the way in the wilderness. You are a light in the darkness, giving us hope once more. Carry us, O God, as we listen to the world's concerns. Here, as we hear the cry of the oppressed, or we learn of new discoveries of injustice, give us knowledge, O God. Teach us to respond with maturity, and give us the courage to act with integrity. Carry us, O God. Bear the pain of this world. Look with compassion on those who are sick, and bring them healing as a sign of your grace. Comfort us, O God. Stand with those of us who sorrow and grieve, so that we might know that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come shall separate us from your love. Love us, O God. Bless us and those we love, our friends and our families, and those who bear us up. As we draw near to you, may we be drawn closer to one another. Bind us together, O Lord, with ties that cannot be broken. Bless those who cannot pray and those who struggle to believe. We hold them in our heart, and we pray that they might be encouraged and that love might dispel fear. Reshape us, O God. Make our church a community of radical discipleship, a signpost towards heaven, so that through us, and if need be, despite us, your kingdom might come. We offer our whole selves to you, O God, our Creator. We often offer you our hands. Use them for the work of your kingdom. We offer our ears and our eyes. May we hear and see stories of joy and of sorrow, so that all might have someone with whom to share their life. We offer our heart and our tears. May we be healed as we care for each other, and in doing so, know your love more fully. And may we offer our faith, our hope, and our love. May our actions be made holy by you, O God, so that we might do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with you. In the safety and comfort of this holy place, O God, give us the courage to lift up our whole selves to you in faith and in silence. Holy God, even in the diversity of our faith, as we approach you in mystery, we offer you our unity as we join together in the prayer that Jesus teaches us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This winter and spring at Kenilworth Union, we have been and will be following the story of Jesus from his baptism to his cross on Good Friday, as that story comes to us from the Gospel according to Mark. And here is a beautiful story from early in Mark's Gospel, chapter 2. When Jesus returned to Capernaum after many days, it was reported that he was at home, and so many gathered around that there was no longer room for them, not even in front of the door, and he was speaking the word to them. Then some people came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. And when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above Jesus. And after having dug a hole through it, they let down the mat on which the paralytic lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he turned to the paralytic and said, "Son, your sins are forgiven. I say to you, take up your mat and go home." And then the man stood up and immediately took the mat and went out before all of them, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this."
Thank you.
Pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Don't you just love the shameless chutzpah of these guys in this story? In the Yiddish dictionary under chutzpah, there's a picture of these guys cutting a hole through the roof. Here's how it all goes down. Jesus starts off his ministerial career with a bang. He's healing all kinds of broke and sick people. He heals an epileptic and then a leper and then some people with dangerously high fevers. And not only that, but he turns out to be a mesmerizing hotshot of a preacher who draws crowds Joel Osteen would be proud of, except that basketball arenas like Mr. Osteen's in Houston hadn't been invented yet, and even the Colosseum in Rome is still 50 years away. So Jesus' huge congregations crowd into these tiny Palestinian homes. And one day, these four friends decide they're going to get Jesus to heal their paraplegic friend. But the house where Jesus is preaching is more crowded than Soldier Field when the Packers are in town, and these guys are in the last row of the nosebleed seats and can't see Jesus for love or money. And then one of them has a eureka moment. In these first century Palestinian homes, you see the staircase to the roof is on the outside of the house. And so up it, they tote their precious cargo. The roof is a thatch of mud and straw laid over crossbeams. So when they get there, these four friends take a pickaxe and a shovel to the roof. They start sawing through the timber. Dirt and sawdust starts raining down on Jesus' head. And then a stretcher floats gently and magically down to the floor at Jesus' feet. In Greenwich, Connecticut, where I lived for a long time, I served on the board of directors of the local ambulance corps. We called it GEMS, Greenwich Emergency Medical Service. And so I was sort of the unofficial chaplain to all the paramedics and EMTs at GEMS, EMTs, the emergency medical technicians. And I sort of like to think of these paraplegics' friends as the patron saints of paramedics and EMTs. Anybody who takes your vitals, loads you onto a stretcher, packs you into the business end of an ambulance with menacing instruments and inscrutable technologies, cranks up the wailing siren, turns on the flashing lights, and delivers you to the great physician. During my preparation for our Civil War classes, I'm meeting all of these interesting and beautiful people, including Clara Barton. Clara Barton was born in Massachusetts in 1821 and started her professional career as a teacher, but then she somehow got it into her head that she wanted to work for the federal government, Lord knows why. So she went to Washington and somehow got a job as a patent clerk. She may have been the first woman ever to work for the federal government. But she was not the only one who was arriving in Washington in the early 1860s. All of these wounded Union soldiers were straggling there looking for food and water and medical care. And so it wasn't long before Clara Barton gave up her day job in the patent office to care for these wounded soldiers. And then it wasn't enough for them to come to her. She went out to them at the front lines. She was there at Antietam, Fredericksburg, and Second Bull Run. She was so close to the action that one time a bullet pierced the sleeve of the dress she was wearing. Along with her exact contemporary, Florence Nightingale, over in England and Europe, Clara Barton was the mother of the modern nursing profession, and also, by extension, paramedics and EMTs. She talked about caring for one youth who, on the verge of death and perhaps a little delirious, thought Miss Barton was his sister, Mary. Always a truth teller and suffering a stab of conscience at the moment, Clara just couldn't bring herself to call him brother. So instead, she kissed his forehead. And she said later, "The kiss of my lips enacted the falsehood my voice couldn't speak. The kiss of my lips enacted the falsehood my voice couldn't speak, she said. Anyway, back to Mark's little story. Sod, straw, and sawdust start raining down on Jesus like he's in a landslide. The roof is literally caving in on him, and then this stretcher falls miraculously to his feet, and this is the part of the story I love. Mark tells us that when Jesus saw their faith, not the faith of the paraplegic, but the faith of the friends, when Jesus saw their faith, he turns to the paraplegic and says, "Your sins are forgiven you. Stand up. Pack up your stretcher and push it home." Isn't that why we stay committed to the church? This limping camaraderie of the lame, the halt, the blind, and the broken? Isn't it because when we can't take another step under our own power, we know someone will come along and carry us to Jesus? Four friends, maybe, each at a corner, one with a shovel, one with a pickaxe, another with a straw, and a fourth with rope and pulleys. Emory University homiletics professor Tom Long says he once had a friend who lost his young wife to cancer at the age of 45. She died 2 weeks before Easter, and he just couldn't bring himself to drag himself to church. He hadn't missed a Sunday at church for 10 years until his wife got ill, but he just couldn't conceive of standing there and singing with the congregation, "Jesus Christ is risen today." His grief had crushed his faith and stolen his voice. But Easter morning early, his friends come to retrieve him at his front door, and they won't take no for an answer. They hustle him into the car and drag him to church. And, you know, to be honest, it didn't help. He felt just as badly after the service as he did before it. He stood politely with the rest of the congregation as they sang the hymns, but he did not sing a word. He was silent and sad and sedimentary as stone. "Jesus Christ is risen today," they'd all shouted at the top of their lungs to organ and trumpet accompaniment. But then, of course, the days and the weeks and the months pass by, and time or God or something or someone begins to heal his broken heart. And the man tells Dr. Long, "I remember thinking that it would have been deceitful for me to sing about resurrection so soon after my wife's death. I didn't believe in resurrection. But I also remember thinking that my friends in church were singing the hymns for me. They were believing in resurrection for me. They pressed their faith in service for me when I had none to know and none to give and none to sing." Mark tells us that when Jesus saw the friend's faith, he said to the paralytic, "Stand up, pack up your stretcher, and push it home." What Mark wants to tell us is that faith is communicative. Faith is viral. Faith is contagious. You can catch it from your friends. Have you ever been so paralyzed by grief that you could not walk? Have you ever been so crippled by injury or illness that you could not stand? Have you ever been so dispirited by disappointment that you were pinned almost literally to your bed? Have you ever been so deep down in the slough of despond that you could not tell whether the sun were shining and you did not care? And when that happened, did four friends come racing to your cot, each at a corner? And did they help hustle you to where help was waiting? And did they drill holes through every obstacle till they dropped you gently at the feet of the Lord near the touch of the great physician? Who here has a story about friends coming to your aid with a shovel, a pickaxe, a saw, and a rope, never giving up till they've dropped you at Jesus' feet? Who here doesn't, right? I'm going to tell you one of my stories, and in the next few days or weeks, you can tell me yours. My children spent their early years, their preschool years, in Grand Rapids, Michigan, a couple of miles from all four of their grandparents. They were very fortunate that way. My parents and my wife's parents helped to raise my children. But then when my son was 9 and my daughter 4, we moved 1,000 miles away. And so the first thing we did when we reached Connecticut was we had to find them a substitute grandparent. And George wanted the job. He was 75 years old at the time. His 100-year-old mother had just died. He'd been an only child, no brothers and sisters. He'd never married. He had no children. He had not one single living relative on this planet. And so George needed a family, and we needed a grandfather. George is gone now, but he was part of my family for 15 years, every single holiday, birthday, many Sunday afternoons. George was a devout Roman Catholic, the most devout Roman Catholic I had ever met. So he went to Mass every Saturday evening in Greenwich so that he could worship on Sunday morning with the Presbyterians. He was actually born and raised on the south side of Chicago. He was a brilliant student and a champion gymnast at the University of Chicago. And when he graduated from the U of C in the early 40s, the United States Army snatched him up and sent him to the University of Michigan to learn Japanese. How could I not have loved him with his master's degree from Michigan? So George was sent by the Army to Tokyo as a spy before they dropped the bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And George was on the USS Missouri when Admiral Nimitz and General MacArthur were there to watch the Japanese surrender. And after the war, George came home to Chicago to work in radio advertising. And then this new phenomenon came along called television, and its epicenter was in New York. And George wanted to be where the action was, so he went to New York, and his office was in Rockefeller Center. And he'd tell me that at his lunch hour, he would wander out onto one of the terraces in 30 Rock and watch the Rockettes rehearse in all their leggy splendor. And he moved to Greenwich when he retired. When George was 85, they found a tumor under his jaw, and it had to be surgically removed, and the surgery went very well, but George was old and weak, and he had tubes and drains coming out of the wound, and we couldn't send him alone back to his modest apartment, and my wife and I would have taken him home with us, but we were scheduled to go on a mission trip to Honduras, and I didn't know what to do, so I drove to the hospital when he was discharged, and when I get there, there he is sitting on the edge of the bed in his street clothes with his bags packed, ready to go. Home? No, not home. I didn't know where. I didn't know what I was going to do, so I paged my friend Phil. Phil's a Presbyterian elder at my church and also the chief of surgery at Greenwich Hospital. I call Phil for all my medical emergencies. If I need an antibiotic, I call Phil. If I sprain my ankle, I call Phil. If I think my daughter has strep throat, I call Phil. He is my Dr. Phil. He is to the First Presbyterian Church of Greenwich what your own Dr. Phil, Phil Jones, was to Kenilworth Union. And so in the present medical emergency, I was calling Phil to see if Phil could set me up with the Visiting Nurse Association or something, anybody to care for Phil while we were away, and I'm in George's room. And so I paged Dr. Phil, and 90 seconds later, he wanders into George's room wearing surgical scrubs and one of those hairnets you wear in the operating suite. He'd obviously just come from his own surgical case, and I said, "Phil, what took you so long?" And I start to unfold my dilemma, and before I can get two sentences out, Phil turns to George and says, "George, I think you need to go to a rehab facility for a week or two to get stronger." And George says, "Not on your life. I'm not going to one of those places. They have only old people there. People die there." And Dr. Phil says, "George, this one's different. This one is called 96 Perkins Road." And George says, "Well, I've never heard of it, and I'm not going there." But what George doesn't know is that 96 Perkins Road is Phil's home address. My 85-year-old friend was going home with the chief of surgery at Greenwich Hospital. George found that to be an acceptable solution. On the way home to 96 Perkins Road, George makes Kathy and me stop at his apartment to pick up his best three-piece suit from the Nixon administration, his polished wingtip shoes, and his most expensive tie, because George is from a different generation, and he's going home with the most distinguished physician in Fairfield County, and he wants to be presentable. When we get home 7 days later from Honduras, George is just fine and back in his own apartment. From one perspective, my friend George is one of the loneliest people on the planet. No living relatives, no children. As far as I know, he's never even had a lover. But from another perspective, my friend George was rich as Croesus. He was like that other George, George Bailey, from It's a Wonderful Life, who discovers eventually that no man is poor who has friends. Sometimes I'm so paralyzed by grief that I cannot stand, or so crippled by illness that I cannot walk. But then these four friends show up, and they drill holes through every obstacle till they lower me at the feet of Jesus. And when Jesus sees their faith, not my faith, but their faith, he turns to me and he says, "Friend, stand up, pack up your stretcher, and push it home." In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thank you.
may be seated. A warm welcome again to you here at Kenilworth Union Church in the service of worship, where we seek to love God and neighbor by doing justice and loving kindness and walking humbly with the Lord our God. One of the spiritual practices that we will be welcomed into in this season of Lent is the labyrinth. There will be a labyrinth laid on the floor in the Culbertson room throughout this coming week, and it will be open all day long. And it is an ancient Christian spiritual practice that allows you to engage your body and mind and soul in the work of worshiping and encountering God. So we welcome you into that space this week. Also, we invite you to participate in our faith and leadership project here. Sally Blount will be speaking on Friday morning, and we hope that you will consider joining us for that. These things and more are part of how we live out our call to be Christ's servants in the world and how we live into Christ's love. And we hope that you might participate in the life of this congregation in new ways this season. We also participate in Christ's love through the gift of gratitude, and our offering here today expresses gratitude to God and ensures that together God's good news might be known both in this community and around the world. Let us worship God with our morning offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, you give us many gifts. We thank you for the places of abundance in our lives, in friendship and finance and faithfulness. These gifts that we bring today are part of our abundance of hope. Hope that you might bless these gifts, that you might bless us, and that you might use these gifts to tell your story of good news to all that we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Now, friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and in the life of the world to come. Amen.